Good morning, and it's lovely to have you joining with us for this online service here in Greenwell Street Presbyterian Church in Newton Ards. It seems that we're going to be sticking with this for some time given the current situation with COVID, and we are just praying that we will still be able to meet together as we have been doing with all our social distancing in place over these past few weeks. Whilst it is not what we want or what we're used to, we're thankful for it, and it does at least give us the opportunity to engage with each other, but also to meet together in our worship of God. Just to remind you that this week live, we have on Thursday evening our midweek Bible teaching and prayer. That's at 7 o'clock in the church hall, and then next Lord's Day, God willing, at 11 a.m. And then our online ministry continues, of course. Our daily devotionals each weekday morning is available to you. And also then on Tuesday evening, our online midweek Bible teaching and prayer. And we're benefiting from the teaching ministry of Alistair Begg, who's looking at the theme of the incomparable Christ. So I would encourage you to join with us if you are able. And if there is any other way that we can help you, whether suggestions you want for books to read or subjects to study, or whatever that might be, please do be in touch, email or phone or text, and we'll be happy to help you and encourage you through these particular days. Well, let us join in worship of God. Let us hear the word of God. Praise the Lord from the earth, you great sea creatures and all ocean depths, lightning and hail, snow and clouds, stormy winds that do his bidding. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His splendor is above the earth and the heavens. He has raised up for his people a horn, the praise of all his saints, of Israel, the people close to his heart. Well, let us join in our worship of God together as we sing our opening praise. Fill your hearts. Further worship God together in prayer. Let us pray. Father, the hymn writer has helped us worship you. We have used the words he penned, but Father, they are the words that help us express our worship and thanks to you. We come, Lord, to acknowledge that our hearts and our mouths and our minds are not always full of our Lord Jesus. Often other things come in and demand attention and demand space and push him to the sidelines. And for that, we are so sorry. And we thank you that when we come together to worship, It certainly helps us to concentrate our minds on the Lord Jesus, who he is, all that he has done. It helps us to concentrate on spiritual things, to remind ourselves that we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of the Lord. It reminds us that we are not just physical creatures indwelt by some spirit, but we are those created after the image of God indwelling this mortal frame. We come to give you our worship, for you are our Creator. Father, there are those who mock such an idea. They believe that this world just happened to come into being. They believe that we just happened to evolve from some slime pit billions of years ago. They believe that these planets in their orbits circling the sun was just a sheer coincidence, that our Earth spinning on its axis at an angle at a precise rate neither spins into the sun nor out into outer space. They believe that that is what happened. Lord, we believe that our God, by a mere word, called all things into being, and in a moment placed every planet where it is and where it needs to be, and created this earth so that it would be a place where mankind, the pinnacle of your creation, could dwell and there enjoy fellowship with his Creator. Lord, we acknowledge that you are God. We acknowledge that you are the one who gives us the breath we breathe, the one who watches over us day and daily, the one who already has our days numbered before one of them came to be. We humbly bow before you. But you're also our Redeemer, because in your great love and mercy, you saw us in our fallen and sinful condition, and you already had planned a way whereby you could bring us back into relationship with yourself, and that through your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you, O Lord, that your love for us was such that you would send your only Son to be a ransom for many. We thank you today that for those who are numbered amongst that many, those who have experienced the wonder of your love and grace in their lives, what a transformation has taken place. In the words of the little song, what a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. O Lord, we acknowledge we are not yet what we ought to be, or indeed what one day we shall be. But we are thankful, Father, that we are not what we once were. And this is all due to your amazing grace. Father, we thank you for the grace given us in your Holy Spirit, he who comes to indwell your people, he who turns our thoughts toward Christ, he who convicts us of our many shortcomings, our failings, our sins, and he who draws us again to the foot of that old rugged cross to know our sins forgiven. Father, we pray that in this time of worship, we may be very conscious of your being with us and your dealing with us. Our prayer on every occasion when we meet to read and study and reflect on your word is, do not pass us by. Lord, minister to our lives. If that is a word of rebuke, so be it. But Lord, don't just leave us alone. We pray that you would come, speak into all our lives, and be glorified, Lord, through us, to the end that our Lord Jesus, being lifted up, might draw many more people, young and old, men and women, into his family and under his lordship. Continue then to present yourself with us and accept of the worship we offer through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We turn then to read together in the Word of God in Isaiah chapter 5. We're working our ways through the prophecy of Isaiah. And this morning we're at Isaiah chapter 5. And we're just going to be reading the first 7 verses. Though when we come to preach on it, we will be making reference to the whole chapter. So Isaiah chapter 5, we're reading the Word of God. And we're starting at verse 1. I will sing for the one I love a song about his vineyard. My loved one had a vineyard on a fertile hillside. He dug it up and cleared it of stones and planted it with the choicest vines. He built a watchtower in it and cut out a wine press as well. Then he looked for a crop of good grapes, but it yielded only bad fruit. Now you dwellers in Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more could have been done for my vineyard than I have done for it? When I looked for good grapes, why did it yield only bad? Now I will tell you what I am going to do to my vineyard. I will take away its hedge, and it will be destroyed. I will break down its wall, and it will be trampled. I will make it a wasteland, neither pruned nor cultivated, and briars and thorns will grow there. I will command the clouds not to rain on it. The vineyard of the Lord Almighty is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah are the garden of his delight. And he looked for justice, but saw bloodshed, for righteousness, but heard cries of distress. Amen. We thank God for this reading in his own inspired and inerrant word. Well, we're continuing to work our way through the questions and answers of the Shorter Catechism. And now that we're up in the Lord's Prayer, we've been taking them just one question at a time as we reflect upon what it is teaching us. So we're into question 105 this morning. And if you're watching this on the screen, please do answer me when we come to that part. Question 105. For what do we pray in the fifth request? Answer. In the fifth request, forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors, encouraged by God's grace, which makes it possible for us sincerely to forgive others, we pray that for Christ's sake, God would freely pardon all our sins. Now, boys and girls, I wonder, have you ever had reason to say sorry? When would you use that word? Well, you would use that word, wouldn't you, if you make a mistake. You would say that word if you had done something wrong, if you had said something unkind. That word sorry is a way of acknowledging that we have done something wrong. And it's not just a word that acknowledges we have done something wrong, but it's a word that is asking the person to whom we say it to forgive us if perhaps we have hurt them in some way. The Bible tells us that we have all sinned. Doesn't matter who we are, the minister, your mum and dad, no matter who, we have all sinned, every one of us. Every one of us needs to say sorry to God. The Bible word for that is, of course, the word repent, which means not just to be sorry, but also to endeavour by God's help to not do that again. And here the prayer reminds us of this thing. It tells us, first of all, that we can only forgive others because God has forgiven us. It says we are encouraged by God's grace, which makes it possible for us to forgive others. You know, sometimes we can feel very hurt. Sometimes we can feel I would never forgive somebody for that. But the Bible would say to us, think of what God has forgiven you. Think of the many times he's forgiven you. Think of the many times he's forgiven you for doing the same wrong thing. And you see, when we realize the extent of God's love and goodness and grace to us, then we are able by his grace to forgive others. But of course, we forgive others because we ourselves have been forgiven. And of course, when Jesus was teaching us this prayer, he wasn't just saying, forgive us our debts. What he was wanting us to do was to think of the ways in which we have done wrong. Think of the things we have said that were not kind. Think of the ways we could have helped, but we chose not to. That's what Jesus wants us to think of. And so perhaps, whether it's at the end of the day or first thing in the morning, when you sit down to read God's word and to pray, think of those things. Lord, in what ways have I done or said something that wasn't kind today? And as the Lord shows you what that was, you can say, Lord, I'm sorry. Please forgive me. And the wonderful promise of the Bible is, if we confess our sins, if we say we're sorry, he is faithful and he is just and he will forgive us our sins. What a wonderful Saviour is Jesus our Lord. We're going to sing together a song that just simply reminds us of this fact. It says, God, forgive my sin in Jesus' name. Trust that you're finding the video overview of the Old Testament helpful. Certainly it's a very enjoyable and concise way to pick up this main theme of the Bible right through. And this morning we're turning to an overview of 1st and 2nd Kings. And following that, with it being the last Sunday in the month, we'll have our mission update and Claire Russell will bring that to us. And then before we turn to the Word of God, we'll be singing one of the Getty settings of Psalm 130, I Will Wait for You.
The books of 1st and 2nd Kings Although they're two separate books in our Bibles, they were originally written as one book telling a unified story that continues on from the book of Samuel that came before it. So David has unified the tribes of Israel into a kingdom, and God promised that from his line would come a messianic king who would establish God's kingdom over the nations and fulfill the promises made to Abraham. So the book of Kings tells the story of the long line of kings that came after David, and none of them lived up to that promise. In fact, they run the nation of Israel right into the ground. The book is designed to have five main movements. The story begins and ends focus on Jerusalem, first with Solomon's reign and the construction of the temple, and then in this last section ending with Jerusalem's destruction and Israel's exile to Babylon. And the story leading up to this tragedy is what makes up the center three sections, which explain how Israel split into two rival kingdoms, how God tried to prevent the corruption of Israel by sending the prophets, and how exile became the unavoidable consequence of Israel's sin. The book opens with two chapters about the kingdom passing from the aging David to his son Solomon. And David's final words to Solomon, they're very similar to those of Moses and Joshua and Samuel to the people. It's a call to remain faithful to the commands of the covenant and to give allegiance to the God of Israel alone. But David's words ring somewhat hollow here, because David and Solomon then go on to conspire how they're going to consolidate this new kingdom through a whole series of political assassinations. It's not off to a great start. Solomon's brightest moment comes when he asks God for wisdom to lead Israel, and he even completes David's dream to make a temple for the God of Israel. Here the story actually stops and describes the design of this temple in detail, just like the tabernacle design in the Torah. There's all these gold and jewels and depictions of angels and fruit trees. It's all symbolism echoing back to the Garden of Eden. It's the place where heaven and earth meet, where God's presence dwells with his people. But no sooner does Solomon finish the temple that he makes some really horrible choices and the kingdom falls apart. He starts marrying the daughters of other kings, hundreds of them, for political alliances. And then he adopts their gods and introduces the worship of those gods into Israel. Solomon then accumulates huge amounts of wealth. He builds a huge army. He even institutes slave labor for all of his building projects. Now, if you go back to the Torah and look at God's guidelines for Israel's kings in Deuteronomy 17, Solomon is breaking every one. So by the time that he dies, Solomon resembles Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, more than he does his father David. The next section of the book opens with Solomon's son Rehoboam acting just like his father. It's a very sad story of greed and lust for power. He tries to increase taxes for slave labor. And under the leadership of Jeroboam, the northern tribes reject this, they rebel and secede, and form their own rival kingdom. And so now in the story, you have the southern kingdom, Judah, centered in Jerusalem with kings from the line of David, and now this new northern kingdom called Israel, whose capital will be Samaria eventually. Jeroboam also goes on to build two new temples to compete with Solomon's temple in the south. He puts a golden calf in each one to represent the God of Israel. The connection to Exodus 32 and the golden calf, it's all quite explicit. From this point on, the story goes back and forth from north to south, tracing the fate of both kingdoms. Each one had about 20 successive kings, and as the author introduces each king, he evaluates their reign by a few criteria. Did they worship the God of Israel alone, or did they promote the worship of other gods? Did they deal with idolatry among the people? And did they remain faithful to the covenant like David, or do they become corrupt and unjust? And according to these criteria, the author finds no good kings in northern Israel, 0 for 20, and then in southern Judah, only 8 out of 20 get a positive rating, which connects to another huge purpose in this book, and that's to introduce the role of the prophets, key figures in Israel's history. So in the Bible, prophets were not fortune tellers. Rather, they spoke on behalf of the God of Israel, and they played the role of covenant watchdogs, which means they called out idolatry and injustice among the kings and the people. They were constantly reminding Israel of their calling to be a light to the nations, that they should obey the commands of the Torah, and so the prophets challenged Israel to repent and follow their God. In these center sections for each king, God then raises up prophets to hold them accountable. And the most prominent prophets are the northern ones, Elijah and his disciple Elisha, right here in the center of the book. Elijah was a wild man of a prophet living out in the desert, and his arch nemesis was the northern king Ahab and his Canaanite wife Jezebel. Together, these two had instituted the worship of the Canaanite god Baal over Israel. And so in a famous story, Elijah challenged 450 prophets of Baal to a contest to see which god was real. So they both build altars and pray to their gods, but only the God of Israel answers with fire. After this, Ahab uses his royal power to murder an Israelite farmer and then steal his family's vineyard. And Elijah again confronts Ahab's injustice, and he announces the downfall of his house. Elijah eventually passes the mantle of his prophetic leadership to a young disciple named Elisha, who asks for 2 times the authority of Elijah. And what's fascinating here is how the author, he's recounted 7 miraculous feats for Elijah, and then he offers stories of 14 acts of power from Elijah. Both prophets were clearly remarkable men, and they played the same role, confronting Israel's kings for idolatry and injustice. And ultimately, they were unsuccessful in turning Israel back from apostasy. In the next section, the northern kingdom is rocked by a bloody revolution started by a king named Jehu, who destroys Ahab's family. And although Jehu was at first commissioned by God, his violence just gets out of control, and it creates the spiral of political assassinations and rebellions from which Israel never recovered. Coup follows coup after Jehu, and each king follows other gods, allows horrible injustice. It all leads up to 2 Kings chapter 17. The big bad empire of Assyria swoops down and takes out the northern kingdom altogether. And the capital city of Samaria, it's conquered, and the Israelites are exiled and scattered throughout the ancient world. Now, chapter 17 is key. The author stops the story and offers this prophetic reflection on what's just happened. He blames the downfall of the northern kingdom on the idolatry and covenant unfaithfulness of Israel and its kings. And so, God has allowed them to face the consequences of their decision. The final movement of the book tells the story of the lone southern kingdom. And here we meet some very heroic kings, like Hezekiah, who trusts God when the armies of Assyria come knocking on Jerusalem's door. Or Josiah, who discovers this lost scroll of the Torah in the temple. So he starts reading it, he's convicted, and he institutes religious reforms to remove idolatry and Canaanite influences from the land. But Judah is just too far gone. The king, right in between these two, Manasseh, he's the worst by far. So he not only introduces the worship of idol statues into the Jerusalem temple, he also institutes child sacrifice. And so God sends prophets to say, the time is up. Israel has reached the point of no return. The final chapters tell the story of the Babylonian Empire coming to invade Jerusalem, destroy the temple, and carry the people and the royal line of David off into exile. And so the story ends, leaving us wondering, is God done with Israel? Is he done with the line of David? Well, the final paragraph zooms about 40 years forward into the exile, and it tells a very odd story. It's about Jehoiakim, a descendant from David, who would have been king if he was back in Jerusalem. And the king of Babylon releases him from prison and invites him to eat at the royal table for the rest of his life, and the book ends. So it's not much, but it's a story that gives a glimmer of hope that God has not abandoned the line of David. So the question now is, how is God going to fulfill his promises to Abraham, to David? How is he going to bless the nations and bring the messianic kingdom? And to answer those questions, you have to read on into the wisdom and the prophetic books. But for now, that's the book of Kings.
Good morning. The first update is from Paul Bailey of Mission Africa. Paul gives thanks that the Reverend Brian Wilson, a Presbyterian minister, has joined the mission and will head out to Nigeria when he raises sufficient funds. Please do pray for Brian as he prepares to go. COVID-19 restrictions are still hampering the work of the mission at home and overseas, as you can imagine. They are attempting some new initiatives, such as a mission team in London working alongside the African churches there, and a mission training week here in Northern Ireland. Please pray for these new ideas. Things are beginning to return to normal for Paul in other ways. His preaching diary is almost full between now and Christmas, and he resumes teaching Old Testament at Union College tomorrow, Monday the 28th. Please pray for good health as things gear up. As you know, both he and Anne have ongoing health challenges, and they would greatly appreciate your prayer in this. Jerry Archer, Wycliffe Bible Translators. Jerry praises the Lord that the team have gelled so well together. There is a camaraderie among them, and they all feel comfortable about sharing their opinions and sharing with each other whether the documents they're reviewing fit or don't fit with their own particular culture. Please pray that the openness within the team would continue. Jerry finds it very interesting to see the variety of languages and cultures that the Lord has created. She is the only mother tongue speaker of English, although it is the common language that's used, and she gives thanks for the clear communication among the team despite this. Please pray that this level of communication continues and that the team continue to enjoy each other's company when they meet up via an online meeting via Zoom. Please do pray for the internet connections, which are kind of vital. And four of the team in particular are in Africa, and the quality of the internet can be a challenge. So please do pray about this. Jerry also asks us to pray for wisdom, patience and insight for her as she leads and guides the team. Elva. As you know, Elva is currently here in the UK. And a few weeks ago, an invitation was made that had previously been made to her when she was here in December, January time. A team that is working in Glasgow invited her to be part of their ministry. They are serving the Iranian, Kurdish and Syrian refugees there. After some time of prayer, Elva accepted, as it was very clear that this was the Lord's direction. The Glasgow team also have a heart for the international community, specifically the Chinese and Spanish speakers. You can see what a good fit Elva is. Of course, now she's looking for accommodation in Glasgow. Please pray that she'd find a mature female Christian who would like to share a flat with her. And alongside the Glasgow ministry, she's going to teach some classes online via the Rio Grande Bible College in America when that whole application process is finished. Finally, Elva is grateful that her master's supervisor is back from furlough, but she does ask us to pray for wisdom as she is finally getting to work on her literature review. Sharon Heron at the International Meeting Point. The Wednesday Bible studies are going well at the meeting point, with about 24-25 people attending. And a Farsi Bible study started on Thursdays. Obviously, with social distancing and masks and all the restrictions, it's very different for people. But please pray that the Lord would bless those who are coming along. Sharon spends 2 days a week at the meeting point and 3 days at the baby shop in North Belfast. The shop is actually very close to the Mater Hospital, and they find that some people drift in while they're putting in time waiting for an appointment. And this can give rise to some lovely opportunities to share the Lord with people and even to pray for them. There's one particular mummy who comes in every week looking for prayer, and she is full of questions about Christianity. Please do pray that the Lord will give her the understanding she needs. There's actually many ladies who call in who are struggling, really struggling, with the circumstances of life. Please pray for Sharon and the team there, the volunteers, as they try to minister to these ladies in the name of the Lord. As Sharon has mentioned before, there's a lovely team of volunteers at the shop, and she takes the opportunity to encourage them in their faith. Please do pray that the Christians there would be built up even as they serve the others. Finally, the shop is looking to hire a manager, and Sharon asks that the Lord's will would be known in this. Whoever they hire will have a significant impact on the shop, so choosing the right person is absolutely vital. The closing date is coming soon, with their interviews probably being held in the first week of October. So please pray about this. Pray that the team would know the Lord's leading. David Surgener at the Vine Centre. David asks us to pray for those who attend the lunch club who are lonely and isolated. For some, the lunch club is the only contact they have with other people. And as you can imagine, these last weeks and months have been very, very difficult for them. There are those who battle depression, and some of them are becoming even more and more depressed. Please pray for David as he tries to maintain some kind of contact with them. There is the possibility of starting a new person in recovery group in Rathfern Estate, North Belfast. Please pray for guidance as to how to move this forward, particularly with the current restrictions, and pray for those who would attend. As always, David asks us to pray for those who are battling addictions, for those in recovery, for those who have relapsed, and for those who continue in their addiction in denial of needing any help at all. Again, he asks us to pray for the young man who moved into his own apartment. For the first time in 14 years, he's living independently without the support of the staff in the hostel. And he's found this very strange and actually very difficult. It's a big change for this young man. Please remember him in your prayers. Again, David values your prayers so much, and he asks that you would pray that he would have guidance and leading, that he'll know how to be used most effectively. He only has so much time. He can't meet all the needs. Please pray that the Lord guides him. Impatso in Malawi. Impatso asks for travelling mercies over these next few days, as she'll be travelling to Embangweni Hospital and its health centres, which means more than 170 kilometres by not so smooth roads. She thanks God for the low COVID-19 cases in Malawi recently. But please continue to pray for Malawi in this. It could change any time and very, very quickly. As always, drugs and COVID-19 supplies are still a big challenge for everyone there. Impatso herself is not 100% recovered from malaria, which she had a few weeks ago. You know how busy she is, so please pray that her body would fully recover and pray that she would be protected from any further infection. Again, she thanks you for your continued prayer support. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we thank you that we can be part of your worldwide ministry, that you can use us to build your church throughout this world. And Lord, we pray for Impatso in Malawi. Father, the situation she faces day in, day out is so challenging. Lord, would you keep her safe as she embarks on this long journey? Lord, may she not be exhausted by the process. Give her a blessed time in these visits. And Lord, do just renew her strength. Father, we pray for health and strength for Paul and Anne Bailey, Lord. We pray that you would be everything that they need, and that you would guide Paul in particular as the mission tries out these new initiatives, trying to see how they can serve you in the new circumstances. Lord, we pray for Jerry, and we pray that you would bless and guide her as she leads this team reviewing the documents. Lord, thank you for the camera D and the clear communication and the fellowship shared among this team. We ask that this would continue, and we pray very specifically that the internet access for the team members in Africa would be of high quality and that they can fully take part in the discussions. Lord, we thank you for Elva, for the fact that she's here at the minute, and for the way in which you've opened up this opportunity to minister in Glasgow. Lord, it is an exciting time, but she needs to find accommodation, and we pray that you would provide a suitable person who would share a flat with her. We ask that the flat would be in the right place. It would be the one of your choice. And Lord, we pray that you'd help her as she continues her literature review for her master's. Help her to be able to focus on this while her mind is occupied with Glasgow. Lord, we do think of Sharon at the International Meeting Point. We thank you for the opportunity she has to share you with those who call into the baby shop. We thank you for the team of volunteers there. And we think specifically of this mom who comes in every week looking for prayer, looking for answers. Lord, would you meet with her and give her the understanding that she needs? We pray for the Bible studies on a Wednesday and a Thursday at the meeting point. We pray that you'd keep safe all those who attend and that they would be richly blessed. We ask that the baby shop, the whole hiring of the manager would go smoothly and that your choice would be very clear. Lord, we think of David at the Vine Centre. Lord, would you give him much, much wisdom about how he should share his time? Lord, so many demands. We pray for the planning for the new person in recovery group in North Belfast. We pray, Lord, that you would guide those who are involved in decision making about how it should progress. And we think of this young man, Lord, in his new apartment. It's such a change. May he know you with him. May you use this in his life, Lord. Keep him safe and away from drugs and addiction. Lord, we pray that if he needs help at any time, he would reach out for it. And we pray for those who go to the lunch club who are suffering from depression, who are really struggling. Lord, help David to know how to help them best. And Lord, we Father, we pray, Lord, that you would bless the work of the Vine Centre in Belfast there. And Lord, we bless you because we know this is your work and that you will achieve all things according to your will and in your time. And we ask this in your name and we leave them with you in Jesus' name. Amen.
I will wait for you on your word. I will rely.
me encourage you to have your Bible open then at Isaiah chapter 5. The use of a story was, of course, a common method used by our Lord Jesus in getting a point across to people, often using stories to illustrate teaching that he was given. You can think of the one, for example, when he's being challenged about who is my neighbour, and he says a man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and so unfolds the story of the Good Samaritan. A story has the power to draw us in. It has the power to disarm us before we realise that in actual fact the story is teaching us a lesson very much about ourselves. You can think of the Old Testament. Perhaps the best example of this is the Old Testament, where you remember David has betrayed Uriah. He has taken his wife. He's arranged for him to be put to the front of the battle so that he'll be killed. And you'll remember how the prophet Nathan comes to David. And we're told that when he came to David, 2 Samuel 12, he said there were two men in a certain town, one rich, one poor. And he goes on with the story. And what do we find? David burned with anger against the man. As surely as the Lord lives, the man who did this deserves to die. And Nathan said to David, "You are the man." A story, you see, drew him in, engaged him, caused him to think about what was right and wrong, but didn't realize at that time that actually the story was about him. And so we find in Isaiah 5, the prophet using that sort of storytelling technique, or in this case, a song that tells a story. But there's one striking difference between what we read here in Isaiah 5 and what we've read previously in Isaiah 1 through 4. And that is, here in chapter 5, there is no note of hope. It is as if divine grace itself has been exhausted. Isaiah is living with the tension between what will be the Mount of the Lord, chapter 2, the Branch of the Lord, chapter 4, and what actually is in the nation around him. He lives in the tension between the glorious future which beckons for the true Israel and the awful reality of its present condition. And of course, that is something that is experienced by ourselves, this glorious hope that is ours concerning the Church of Christ and concerning us as individual believers. And yet, the sense of failure and weakness here on earth. But here in chapter 5, the focus is upon what the Lord could rightly expect from his people. And the important point for us is that God's grace toward us in salvation is designed preeminently to bring men and women, boys and girls, from lives bound by sin to be those marked by holiness or fruitfulness. And so it is to this we turn this morning, as we're given a picture in this song or story of a fruitless vineyard. It was Martin Lloyd-Jones who said, "When the church is absolutely different from the world, she invariably attracts it. It is then that the world is made to listen to her message, though it may hate it at first." So turn with me then into Isaiah 5, and let us notice, first of all, God's purpose revealed. God's purpose revealed. Here we are told the purpose of God's choosing of and redeeming of Israel as his own. We have it in the latter part of verse 2. He looked for a crop of good grapes. Now this takes us to the very heart of God's purpose in salvation. It is in actual fact the answer to the question, what are we saved for? Of course, when we turn into the Old Testament, we know exactly what Israel was saved for. It is spelled out to us. Deuteronomy 7, verse 6, for example. You are a people holy to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you out of all the peoples on the face of the earth to be his people, his treasured possession. They were to be a holy people. That's why he chose them. That's why he redeemed them. And of course, when we turn into the New Testament, we find exactly the same thing being said. And that, of course, comes as no surprise to us. Paul, writing in Ephesians 1, would say to us, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world. To what purpose? To be holy and blameless in his sight. Or as Paul puts it in Titus, as he writes his little pastoral letter to him, Titus 2 and verse 12. It teaches us, that is, the grace of God teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright and godly lives in this present age. For Israel, as with the New Testament church, God was looking for lives that were lived to his honour and to his glory and to his praise. And of course, this fruitfulness would be most evident in the first instance in obedience itself. And so when you go back again to the Old Testament, into Deuteronomy 6 and verse 1, these are the commands, decrees and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land you are crossing the Jordan to possess, so that your children, their children after them, may fear the Lord your God as long as you live. You see, obedience was to be one of the evidences of God's grace at work in the lives of his people. But not in the sense of these are things you have to do, but rather, as the psalmist reminds us in Psalm 1, his delight was in the law of the Lord. And you see, this is the result of God's work, isn't it? It's the result of his grace at work within us. We're familiar, aren't we, with the words of the prophet Ezekiel in chapter 36, when he says, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. That is, God himself has wrought this change in us. God himself has taken away the old heart and has given us a new heart upon which the law of God is written, so that the law is no longer an outward compulsion we have to obey, but an inward delight that we're delighted and pleased to obey. And so the evidence of God's grace at work in a life is that that life will display love and obedience to God. Paul spells it out, doesn't he? He says, the acts of the sinful flesh in Galatians 5, but the fruit of the Spirit. The acts, the deliberate acts, the deliberate actions brought about by the sinful nature, but the fruit of the Spirit, the evidence of God's Spirit at work in us, is that there will be in our lives all this evidence of love, joy, peace, goodness, kindness, gentleness, and so on. These things will be there. Jesus himself, of course, used this same analogy, and we would have every reason to believe that he was drawing on the Old Testament analogy when he used it. John 15, I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Or you remember how in the Sermon on the Mount, verses that are a constant warning bell to us, whereas he comes to close that address as recorded for us. He tells us in verses 16 and following, by their fruit you will recognize them. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit. A bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Thus, by their fruit you will recognize them. For us, the Sermon on the Mount, the epistles, they're full of practical examples of what a fruitful life ought to look like. And that's what God's purpose in salvation is. It is that these lives of ours will be lived in obedience to him, and hence, in so doing, bring honour and praise and glory to his name. That is, he has saved his people to be fruitful people. But that then brings us to the second thing, and that is God's disappointment, if we can say that reverently, God's disappointment revealed. What are we told here in Isaiah chapter 5? We are told, then he looked for a crop of good grapes, but it yielded only bad. Now let me just pause here for a moment, because there are those who would say, oh, well, I'm not bad, or at least I'm not that bad, as if that means they're actually good. But listen again to Jesus, because in that passage in John 15, when he makes reference to himself as the vine, he says in verse 2 of 15, he cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit. That is, a bad tree isn't just a tree that produces bad fruit. A bad tree is a tree that produces no fruit. A good tree produces good fruit. A good tree does not produce no fruit. That's important for us to remember this, because very often people are judging themselves, and you may be one of those, and you're comparing yourself to other people and you're saying, I'm not really that bad. But that is not the test that's being asked here. God's disappointment is expressed not because there is no fruit, but because there is bad fruit. And bad fruit is as useful as no fruit. That is, it's useless. But Israel was producing bad fruit. And verses 8 to 23 of chapter 5, and you can read that through at your own leisure, highlights the different ways in which that was true. Let me just highlight six different areas that the prophet teaches on. He touches on greed. He touches on drunkenness. He touches on cynicism. He touches on perversion, on foolishness, and on corruption. And the Lord has every reason to be disappointed with his people. For what reason? Well, we're told here. What more, verse 4? What more could have been done for my vineyard than I have done for it? Look how God's care of his people is described. They're described, verse 2, as the choicest vine. God didn't choose the people because they're the most numerous. He chose them because he set his love upon them. They were the choicest vines of all peoples upon the face of the earth. He set his love upon them. And we see that, don't we? The calling of Abram from the Ur of the Chaldees, from his pagan worship. We see that, don't we, when they're brought out of Egypt, delivered from the bondage. Let my people go. And they're described as being placed in a vineyard. And what are we told about that vineyard? He dug it up. He cleared it of stones. He built a watchtower in it. He cut a wine press for it. You see, it was cleared of its enemies. It was watched over. The nation was watched over by its prophets and by its priests, by its leaders. It was cared for. It was nurtured. It was encouraged. It had its sacrificial system in which God taught them about his own holiness and yet his own grace, and how a holy God could be approached but only through the shedding of blood. He gave them his law. His law that wasn't just something that was something to be obeyed, but a means by which their community and their lives could be fruitful. He gave them prophets who came with words of encouragement, but also with words of warning. And what more could have been done? God had done everything for his people. And yet when he looked for the fruit of that, he saw only bad. And of course, this inevitably points us forward to the cross. There you have the ultimate solution to our sinful rebellion. There at the cross, all that is necessary is done. There is nothing more needs or can be done. When Jesus utters those words, "It is finished," the work of salvation of a great multitude that no man can number is complete. There is nothing more needs to be offered. He has offered his own son in the place of guilty sinners. And as a result of this, the Lord can truly anticipate a harvest of fruitful souls. But what if, like Israel, in spite of all the provision that is made, a life, whether it's Old Testament or New Testament, remains fruitless, or indeed worse? What then? Well, the third thing that we see: God's purpose revealed, God's disappointment expressed, God's judgment declared. Verses 5 through 7. As the Lord comes to declare judgment, what does he do? Well, that judgment will be described in verses 24 through 30. He invites, through this song, through this telling of this story, he invites the residents of Judah to judge for themselves. They knew their history. They knew how they had been delivered. They knew how their forefathers had received the law. They knew how they'd been brought into the promised land and their enemies had been driven out before them. And so they knew that they were this vineyard that had been so well cared for and for which everything that could be done had been done. And they knew that what was now about to befall them was exactly what they deserved. Verse 5, "Now I will tell you what I am going to do to my vineyard. I will take away its hedge and it will be destroyed. I will break down its wall and it will be trampled." Do you notice that? God is going to withdraw his care. God is going to withdraw his protection. And when he does so, those enemies that before were driven out before them will come back and overrun them. Of course, this will ultimately take place with the coming of the Babylonians and the destruction of Jerusalem in 587 BC. And when you read through the judgments described, verses 24 through 30, listen to that last verse. "In that day they will roar over it like the roaring of the seas. And if one looks at the land, he will see darkness and distress, and even the light will be darkened by the clouds." And that's where this stops. There is no glimmer of hope here. There is no shaft of light here. You get a similar note, don't you, when we turn into the New Testament? Because the scriptures are consistent in their teaching. And so this comes as no surprise that we find the same things being said in slightly different ways. So in Matthew chapter 23 and in verse 57, Matthew 23 and verse 37. "O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often I've longed to gather your children as a hen gathers her chicks, but you were not willing. Look, your house is left to you desolate." It's exactly the same Israel didn't learn its lesson. When the Christ would come, their Messiah, they would reject him. And in rejecting him, they had as a nation reject their last and only hope. This is, of course, the picture that you have in John 15. Often people have been confused about what is being said here. They have read these words, "I am the true vine and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit." And they say, well, clearly, if someone is in Christ, then they're a believer. And if they're cut off, they're a fruitless believer. And so you can be saved and lost. But that's not what's being taught here. When you think of Israel and it's being described as a vine, not every person born in the nation of Israel was a true follower of Jehovah God. We know that. We have seen that in our video overview of the Old Testament. It is plain and clear that there were those who were faithful to God and there were those belonging to the covenant people of God who clearly had no personal love to God himself. And what you have in John 15 is this covenant picture where people having been brought up in the covenant or amongst the covenant people, in our theology, baptism is the sign of the covenant. All who receive the sign of the covenant come in, as it were, to the covenant family, the covenant community. In that sense, through baptism, they are joined with Christ. But if, as they grow up, there is no evidence in their lives of their own commitment to and profession of Christ, their lives, that is, bear bad fruit or perhaps are fruitless, then what happens to such people? Well, you see, what they can't do is say, but I was baptized. Because in saying that, they're actually adding to their own condemnation. Because being part of the covenant community, God can rightly expect there to be fruit born of that relationship. But where there is not, they are cut off. They no longer belong to the covenant community of God's people. Like those of Isaiah's day, "I am the vine. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers, and such branches are picked up and thrown into the fire and burned." So it would be for Judah in Isaiah's day. And you see, like Isaiah's day, those who continually reject God's gracious offer of salvation will find to their loss that a day may come when it is no longer offered to them. You know, the presumption of people is that I can put off accepting Christ until another day. Well, you see, you've completely misunderstood that, if that is you, because you are working on the premise that it lies within your power to decide whether to follow Christ or not. When you look at the Gospels, you find Christ calling people to follow him. "Come, follow me. My sheep hear my voice and they follow me." For you to presume that you will hear the voice of Jesus say, "Come unto me and rest," in the future, whenever you are so blatantly disregarding that voice here and now, is the height of presumption. Today, the scripture says, is the day of salvation. And how can you know that you are a Christian or not? Some of you may be asking that very question. How can I be sure? Well, Jesus tells us. And with these points of application, we close. The first thing is this: by their fruit, you will know them. Paul tells us to examine yourself to see if you're in the Lord. That is, the evidence of true Christian faith will always be seen Now listen, this is not to say that the Christian doesn't do things that are wrong, doesn't think wrong things, doesn't say inappropriate things. But what it does mean is that within the true Christian, within the person who has known the grace of God in their lives, transforming them, there will be a longing to worship God. There will be a longing to speak with God in prayer. There will be a desire after his word. There will be a greater and deeper love for Jesus Christ. And this will be seen in a life of self-control, of kindness, of gentleness, of faithfulness. It is by their fruit you know them. In that same passage, Jesus said, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father, which is in heaven." And the will of the Father is that everyone who looks to the Son will be saved. Ask yourself the question as you look at your life. I'm not asking you to tell me that you don't have bad things. I'm asking you to tell me, what good fruit do you see? What Christian graces do you see? What desires after Jesus Christ and the things of Christ do you see? Because if they're not there, if there's no evidence of those, then you see, Jesus says, you're not a good tree. A good tree produces good fruit. And perhaps today is that time when, by God's grace, he is using this story of the vineyard in your life to cause you to pause and reflect and perchance to hear his voice call you to come and to receive him as your Saviour and Lord. Because the warning of Scripture still stands. Hebrews 2. How shall you escape if you neglect? It's all you need to do. You don't need to oppose it. You don't need to go out and shout out against it. You just need to neglect such great salvation. And what a great salvation it is. Think of what God has done for a sinner like you. Think of how he has sent his Son. Think of how he has poured out his wrath upon sin borne by his Son. And he has done this all for a sinner like you. And Isaiah's words could be spoken today to you. What more can be done? There's nothing more needs to be done. God has done all that there is to be done. And today, he calls you to come to him and to rest in what he has done. And by his grace at work in your life, to begin to manifest the fruit of God's Spirit. Judah, as a nation, was a fruitless vineyard. May God grant that all who love and know Christ may be fruitful in their lives to him. Let us pray. Our loving Father, we are not left to wonder about whether we are truly yours or not. Jesus has given us a clear way in which we can know for ourselves. By their fruit you shall know them. Lord, here is the challenge. Do I love Jesus? Is he my only hope for salvation? Do I love his word, his people, his church, his worship? Do I love seeking to follow and obey him day and daily? Lord, we pray that you would speak through this sung story into the lives of many who are sharing with us in this service today. And may there be those for whom this story hits home. And today, in turning to Christ, they pass over from death to life. And their lives begin to manifest fruitfulness in his service. And we ask it In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing together in closing a hymn that reminds us, in effect, of what God has done when I survey the wondrous cross. Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and evermore. Amen.